All right, excellent. First and foremost, again, Leslie Elwell, and I am an alumni of KU. Came to the U.S. actually 25 years ago with a Fulbright scholarship, and I chose KU as my university. So great choice. Go KU. Going back to the time that we're going to spend here together, we've got 2 hours. And that's a lot of time for you. And I'll tell you, while I'm excited to be here virtually, I am more excited to finish 2020 and get on to 21 so that we can be in person. And I know that all of you are kind of like on the same boat. I believe so. Pretty confident. So thank you for really investing this time, because it's a lot. So because you have given 2 hours of your time, which is a lot, we want to make sure that you leave this hour, after being with us, that you leave with more information that you had prior to the 2 hours, and that we answer some questions that you didn't know how to ask, and or no one had been able to actually guide you or answer them for you. So hopefully we'll make it productive and engaging, and you learn something new. So thank you for that. In terms of, before we just jump into that content, let me tell you a little bit more about KC Global Design. I'll tell you, I shared with you that I came here to KU and to Kansas City 25 years ago, and I didn't realize that KC is really known for design. And we at KC Global Design are making an effort to make sure that that is really known not only here, but in the country and in the world. In case you didn't know, KC is the number one city for sports architecture in the world. KC designers work on some of the largest and most important solar arrays on the planet. KC engineering pioneers water sustainability around the globe. We have here in the metro area, little and large companies, I'll tell you, probably over 40. With KC Global Design, today we have 24 companies that you see here, that you have an ability to learn what they do, what they don't do, right? How they work, how they behave, so that you can better understand, what your likes and what your lifestyle and what your values are and how they align to these companies, so that you can make the best choices for your careers. Again, it's amazing, the number and the quality and the work that all of these companies represent. And I am so honored to be the co-chair of this consortium, of this group that really comes together to ensure that we make you aware of the choices, that we answer the questions for you, that we attract more of you, and that we keep you here. So that's what KC Global Design is about. Having said that, now I am going to introduce my partners today here in the panel. I've got three amazing, young leaders in the area, right? We've got Darius Hallwell. Darius, are you there?
Yes.
Awesome. All right. Jim Mendenhall.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Hi, Jim. And Rachel Havery. Rachel?
Hi, everyone.
I think I saw you. Excellent. All right. So, instead of me introducing you, I want to ask you a first question. Just tell me a little bit about you and tell all of us, and also why you chose to live in Kansas City. So who wants to go first? Rachel, is that okay?
Yeah, I'm happy to take it. So everyone, my name's Rachel Haverty, and I'm originally from South Arkansas, so you might hear me say y'all today. So just know that that's where that comes from. I went to the University of Arkansas, actually, and then landed in Kansas City after graduation. I actually graduated with my Bachelor's of Science in Civil Engineering. However, I am now in recruiting, but at the same firm, Burns McDonnell. So different background and stuff. But I know that when I was looking for full-time employment, I was kind of focused on DFW, so Dallas-Fort Worth area in Kansas City, just with the opportunities that engineering had to offer in those locations. And plus, it wasn't too far away from home. But obviously, Kansas City won, and I'm very happy to be here. And there's just a great engineering-centered location, as well as, a young professional environment, even at Burns and McDonnell, that really drew me up here, including, obviously, the job opportunity itself. Lots that drew me here, including like the culture, the professional development or professional environment, like I said, but it's like a small city, or it feels small because everyone knows each other, but it's a big city, especially compared to where I grew up. So yeah, that's what brought me here to Kansas City.
Thank you, Rachel. Jim.
Yeah, so I'm Jim Mendenhall. I'm an engineering manager at Zahner here in Kansas City, and been here for 11 years at the company. And more about me, just have two young children, which is definitely changed my perspective on things a lot. But as far as Kansas City, what really has brought me here and kept me here, I think it's a great balanced city. It's got a really fantastic cultural institutions, you know, a lot of things to do around the city. They've got a great restaurants, great nightlife, that type of thing, which is maybe what kept me here in my 20s. And now that I have two kids, some of the other stuff that keeps me here, just a lot of open space, green space, plenty of areas to get out and ride bikes, that type of thing. And yet still be right near downtown. Our office is downtown and I live close enough to ride my bike into work. But also can commute and don't have to deal with 2 hours of traffic, that type of thing. So it's just a very, very balanced city overall, and a great place to live. Also, just as far as, you know, nice airport, I love to travel. Obviously, that's been a little difficult here recently, but in general, can get places pretty quickly. So that's fantastic. And then come home and enjoy the city for what it is. And as mentioned, there's a lot of firms here, a lot of great talent. That, you know, Zahner has seen people come from other firms in the city, and there's a lot of that talent mix around that keeps flowing here just because of all the great firms we have.
Thank you, Jim. Darius?
Hi, everyone. So I was born and raised in Kansas City, and I'll be the one weird guy here. I actually went to K-State, not KU, but still here to help. I think I still have things to offer here. Graduated with a Master of Architecture degree back in 13, and went to go work for 360 that got bought out by HOK a few years back. The reason I'm in KC, so my senior year in college, me and a few of my friends during our spring break took our resume and our portfolio, and we road trip to New York. All of us were kind of from Kansas City, and we didn't necessarily want to come back. So we took our stuff out there, interviewed at a lot of places, got a few offers, but then 360 Architecture called me, and they're out of Kansas City. And if, for those of you who don't know, 70-80% of all sports architecture in the world come out of Kansas City. So I really like that. I could probably stay home, stay around my family. I'm sure my mom liked that, and still have this global reach. With what I wanted to do in the design field.
Thank you so much, Darius, for sharing. You know, that's just heartwarming to hear. You know, I myself, right, as you heard, I'm from Venezuela. Had a chance to, you know, live in Europe, in Spain and France, and then in Japan. Came to the U.S. to Kansas City and have been able to really travel all the U.S. because balancing the costs, right, of Kansas City and the global opportunities that the companies offer here have been the most amazing balance that I've seen in my career. So just wanted to share that, you know, for your food for thought as you think about, you know, where's the best place to live and enjoy and to really have a very, you know, impactful job and work that's not only impact the community, but also the country and the world. So, you know, just I can't say enough about the design industry here. Second question. So what do you find most interesting and or rewarding about your job? So I'm gonna start with you, Darius, now.
Okay. So at HOK, we kind of have every building type in every market that you could think of, which is really awesome. I don't know if they tell you this in school, but after you come out of school, you sort of specialize in a certain building type. Typically, according to what your firm goes for. And I really enjoy the versatility of working in so many markets. I worked in pro sports, college sports, community commercial, healthcare. So that versatility is really awesome and interesting because you get to see a lot of different project types and travel to a lot of different places. Working, the rewarding part, I would say, on one hand, I'm probably a little bit of a diva, so I like the glamour of sports, like it's on TV, it's on in video games, things like that. But things that really warmed my heart over the past few years was, you know, working within the community, getting to know those people who aren't necessarily billionaires, but a little bit of help that you sort of give them with your design abilities goes a much further way and is a lot more fulfilling.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you for sharing. Rachel, would you mind going next?
Sure, I can kind of speak twofold because, like I said, I have an engineering background, but no longer practice it necessarily, but now recruit it. So from the engineering standpoint, I definitely enjoyed like the designing and creation of something of your own, obviously with some client standards that you had to abide by. But as a consultant at Burns & McDonnell, you're the professional. So you're the one who's sought after. The clients are essentially like, if you think of yourself as a patient going to a doctor, the doctor is the consultant. So at Burns & McDonnell, you're the professional that we seek, that is sought after, and getting to put your own spin or your creativity, like I said, into these designs was really rewarding. On the HR side of things, I mean, obviously enjoying meeting new people and hearing their stories and why there's the passion behind the why of like what drives them. Kind of hearing like Darius's story, for instance, just a second ago, like what drew him towards sports and that sort of design. But basically helping people find that next chapter, because I do more early careers recruitment, so college age interns, that's why I'm here. Helping to find that passion and then like figure out where they best fit in. So lots of rewards that definitely comes from the job here. And I've seen it on both sides now, production and operations.
Thanks for sharing, Rachel. Jim?
Yeah, so speaking about Zahner specifically, one of the huge things I love is the wide variety of projects we get to work on. We do architectural metal work, but also art type projects. Metal based. So might be one project is a, you know, relatively small art piece. And then another project that we actually just finished was the exterior skin on SoFi Stadium. If you watched the game versus the Rams recently, there were a lot of shots of that. So huge range and project types that we work on. And so it just keeps things very interesting. Also just the way we approach projects because of that variety, there's a lot of innovation. So every project we're looking to kind of innovate how we're doing things. You're not repeating the same steps over and over. So that's just a hugely engaging thing that keeps people around. It does take the right type of person, but that type of person that fits, it really thrives here. In general with AEC, one of the things I love is just the ability to, end of the day, you're creating something tangible. You know, whatever part of the process you're in, whether it's design, you know, fabrication, or even kind of installation, construction, overseeing that, you know, you're part of that process that ends in something tangible you can see. And sometimes that can be over a huge time frame, 5 years plus, but at the end of the day, you've got something tangible that if it's done right, should last and have an impact for potentially decades or more. So that's just a very rewarding thing about the industry in general.
Thanks, James. How rewarding. You know, I'll tell you, for me, I'm also an engineer by training, and I loved to build things that work. That's what I learned. And to actually partner with, you know, the HOKs, the Hendersons, right, the companies that are here with me, with us in KC Global Design, and see how an idea comes from a design with the architects to how that moves into the estimation to actually bring, you know, a plan to life, to talk to the clients, to see how it's going to build, and then to see the fun of the actual construction, and what are the things that work and don't work, you know, around the design, right? Because you can design a beautiful thing right in the sun, right there in the mountain, and then you realize the mountain has a little hole, and then you have to figure out how to fit it, right? And so those conversations between the architects, the engineers, and the people that build the buildings, I just get so much out of it. While I love what I do here at the office, my favorite time is it's out in the field. So, you know, I expect and hope that you'll have an amazing career in any or all those areas in the next 10, 20 years to come. So here's a great question for you and for all of us to listen to, because, you know, as I put myself as a student, whether, you know, I think about when I was a sophomore and a junior and or a senior in college and was getting closer to thinking about all the things that I had to think about to make a decision, you know, what advice would you give students that are here today, 70 plus, that are attending, that you wish someone would have told you, or you wish that you would have known at the time that you were making a decision? Jim, I'll start with you, since I haven't started with you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, there's so many different things you could answer this question with, but one of the things that came to my mind, and this is something we look for a lot on resumes, is kind of some experience with automation, with programming languages, that type of thing, which is a pretty expansive topic, but that ability to automate work that you're doing throughout AEC can have a really great impact on your ability to do the work. On the design side, it allows you to iterate through many design possibilities quickly. It allows you to test things with just tweaking parameters and you'll quickly get results versus having to redo something by hand, starting from scratch each time. And then all the way through, which, you know, Zahner were involved in design, manufacturing and construction. For manufacturing, it allows us to really kind of have that force multiplication where we set up well-scripted processes that then are able to produce huge amounts of parts that run through our shop quickly. And so then that gives us time to focus on the details, focus on the overall aesthetic, focus on the details that really matter. So that's something that in general, just that doesn't have to be any specific scripting language, that type of thing, but it's overall just that type of thinking, I think is critical. So that's the thing I would really have maybe wanted to know more when I was in school.
Thanks, Jim. How about you, Rachel?
Sure. I will say that, like, I mean, at the beginning of your career, wherever you decide to go, or even an internship, you're probably going to hear a mentor, a manager, or just a colleague say, there are no dumb questions, or don't be afraid to ask a question. But, you know, what would set you apart from just, you know, like going to these people, these resources, and asking a question would be to think through the question, see if you can figure out a possible solution, like maybe based on some of your classes that you've taken, or maybe a previous design process that kind of relates, and then proposing your possible solution as well. That challenges yourself and like your knowledge base already. In addition to, it shows the person, your resource that you're asking, that you're not just going to continually come with repetitive questions that you've already looked at in the past, but also you've thought through it, thought through certain methods, used your resources, your existing resources, and kind of want to collaborate maybe more so than just straight ask a question. But I think it'll help you learn, like I said, as well as receive feedback too, because you can maybe, like I said, collaborate more so with like an actual solution versus just having a yes, no answer, or like, here's the design process or the steps that you need to take in order to arrive at the destination. So yeah, don't be afraid to ask questions, but in addition to the question, come with a possible solution too.
Thank you, Rachel. Darius, how about you?
I had to go last. They took all my answers, but that's okay. I think the main point, in college, you learn a lot, but it is just the seed of the amount of stuff that you're going to have to learn. So never stop learning. Like, again, continue to watch those program tutorials, continue to watch out. Design trends are developing over time, things like that. And the other big thing I would say is be yourself. You know, everybody else is taken. Be original, drawing your own personal experiences, your ability, your traveling, and your interactions with your friends and people in your community. And then bring that to the table. Everybody has this basis of who they are just from going to a good school like KU, and they can deliver certain things on a daily basis within the design process. But the things that starts to separate you from others is you. So be yourself.
Thank you. Thank you, Darius. Gosh, those are great, you know, just great advice. You know, I'll tell you from my chair, when I was, you know, if I look at, you know, gosh, when I was a junior and a senior, what I didn't know, right, that I wish someone would have told me was, focus, balance your focus on not only what you are learning to produce and to contribute to the company, to also learn what to ask and what to look for to know if that's really something that I really have a lot of passion for, and to understand, you know, what drives me more, what makes it a great day for me. When I think about, you know, think about your last year and think about the best 10 days, right? COVID, you know, impacted is an interesting one, but maybe another time. And think about the 10 not so great days. What was it about those days that made you have so much passion and feel so awesome? The days that you weren't so great, think about what was it about it that they weren't so great. And think about those things as you look for the work in the company that you want to spend at least, you know, your first couple of years to get, you know, just your solid foundational just experience in. So just a thought for you. So thank you so much for sharing. You know, hopefully you got a little bit out of this and some thought-provoking questions for us. Next, we're actually going to go into breakout rooms now that we started kind of getting into these topics, right, to make you think and to challenge us and ask us just to help you out. You know, a couple of things that I'll put out there just to start a conversation, right, is, you know, as you're thinking about preparing for interviews, either for internships and or for positions, right? Of course, right? Of course, you're going to talk about, you know, the skills that you have gained, the knowledge that you have gained, right, through your academics and your other non, you know, extracurricular activities. What's really interesting is what questions you should ask, you know, and of course, you want a company that has a great culture. But how do you know that? Everybody says they have a great culture, right? So how do you know that, right? Second, of course, you want to work for a great manager. Who doesn't? You want to work for a great leader, right? How do you know if the person is really a great leader or not? What do you listen for? What do you look for? So I think all of us will share our experiences around that, you know, and if we have time, you know, when you start working an internship or a job, you know, I'm a fan to say anybody has 30 days to build a brand, whether you design it or not. So you can let it be, or you can think about what the brand is that you want to, you know, portray when you start a job. You know, I've learned tons about, you know, great brands of products. Companies have brands. You saw those companies and some, you're like, oh yes, of course I know. Some, maybe not so much, right? Companies have brands. Departments have brands. You have a brand. I have a brand. So it's so important for you to think about those things when you start work, right? And questions that you should be thinking about and how to prepare for that is going to make a difference in your first day, in your year, and in your career. So we just want to help you think through that and help you out. Anything, Darius, Jim, Rachel, that you want to jump and add to that?
No, that was great.
All right.
Yeah, I think that covers it.
Okay. Mary, Merrill, help us out.
Yes, we wanted to take a minute. We've been monitoring the chat and are still waiting for some questions from students that we wanted to open up to the entire panel before we break out into breakout rooms. Does anyone have any questions that they have for our panelists here? And just a reminder, we have that wonderful $50 gift card that we'll be raffling off for questions that come in.
And Mary, we have additional questions, right, around how COVID has affected us, you know, how we function, are we planning to change, you know, so anything, right? Yep. And anything that you really would love to learn, you know, please.
This is awesome. So I'm seeing the chat. Thank you, students, for chiming in here. And Leslie, to your point, the first question was about COVID. So I'll put it out to the group, to our panelists. How has working at your company changed over the last 6 months due to COVID? What do you expect to change in the next 6 months?
I'll go. So here's the good news. What we do as architects translates pretty well from your desk at home. Like, you can work, no problem. And then through virtual meetings like this, you can still interact with the clients and all your consultants. You can even have digital sketch sessions, still produce all the drawings and everything you need to do. The thing that changed is our industry economically maybe took a little bit of a dip just because there's a little bit of being scared about what the future holds on the client side. So that is all just to make you guys feel more comfortable about still being in the industry. It's still awesome. We're still getting work. We'll be okay.
Yeah, I can piggyback off of Darius and kind of say similar that our engineers, because we have gone really virtual, we use Microsoft Teams at our office. So it really helps with the collaboration aspect because that's something that we really do, I guess, strive to meet because our engineers, not only are you working like with your department, so you have like, if you're a mechanical engineer, you're working with other mechanicals, but there's a lot of cross hybrid, you know, like working with the electrical engineers on the actual design of the building as well, or the civil engineers on the foundations that your structures have to sit on. So, you know, these people might not sit right next to you even naturally in the office as well. And so just collaboration naturally has been pretty foolproof, which has been great. There has been obviously adjustment trying to get into that virtual swing. But I think the flexibility, like what I foresee in the next 6 months, I think that there will be about the same flexibility even without the pandemic involved, that if you need to work from home a little bit more often than you were pre-pandemic, that that will be allowed, or at least it'll be up for more discussion. But yeah, similar to Darius, like luckily we're diversified enough in our industries that we still have work coming in. Some departments more busy than others for sure, but still a good variety of them, which helps.
Yeah, and just to add what Darius and Rachel both said, I mean, very similar situation here at my company. We do manufacturing at our facility, which one extra thing that's been tricky with us is you, with most people working remotely in engineering, you kind of lose some of that direct physical interaction with the parts that are being built. So that's been a little difficult to maintain, but we still, you know, kind of come in when we need to. I'm obviously in our office right now. This is not my house. So it's been a challenge. And on the collaboration side, it's definitely been a challenge trying to keep those same, the things that are easy to do in person can be a little trickier to do on video conferencing or phone calls, as far as maintaining relationships, maintaining that collaborative spirit. But it's been good. I think we've made good progress there. So
I'll jump in there. I had to drop off for a second, so I missed a little bit of the presentation. My son was exposed to COVID, so this is like a real life COVID situation I'm kind of dealing with right now. But I think as far as, you know, how it's affected business, kind of similar to the other panelists, you know, we look at these challenges like this as opportunities to grow. And I think this has provided a really good opportunity for us to like explore Microsoft Teams. And I think it's a really good collaboration tool. Zoom has been a very effective tool. But definitely the face-to-face meetings are kind of more, we get a lot more done in those situations in some cases. In some cases, we can meet virtually and discuss a certain item over the phone, over Zoom, over Teams, and collaborate just fine. It's actually much more efficient than actually making the time to take a trip out there, bring a set of plans, et cetera. But in other cases, especially inter-office, what we're finding, inter-office collaboration, it's just more efficient to go, you know, to have the person right next to us in the cubicle and say, hey, the mechanical load changed to this, what are we doing electrically? So that kind of quick interaction, we found at Gibbons Drake Scott that, you know, we're much more efficient in the office. So I'm at home right now. But generally we're back in the office. We did take, I think 8 weeks, off where we were remote, all remote, but, so we have the capability of doing that. But you know, we're much more efficient being, in the office and able to collaborate in real time. So.
Thank you. Thanks so much for sharing. You know, I see other questions coming through and the answers were just outstanding. So I'm going to address kind of like three questions around how essential is a summer internship, advice graduating in 2 years, how important it is to have an internship, or what's the most, you know, advice that we can give in our area. And I'll tell you, internships, I would say absolutely are critical. And the reason why they're critical is because, you know, not only about the academic work and the work itself of the design, you know, I'll tell you what we look for, right, are people that are hungry, humble, and smart. You know, it's that critical thinking. It's the, how do you ask questions? How do you communicate? I will tell you, communication is so important. The ability to succinctly articulate what you're thinking, to succinctly articulate your questions verbally, in writing, to your peers, to a boss, to a, you know, a worker that is, you know, in construction, right? That's what internship is best at. Is best at how to collaborate. There was a question around conflict, right? And how to, you know, manage a tough client, right? I'll tell you, a tough client, whether an architect, an engineer, or in construction, know your contract. In HR, I still say, show me the contract, right? Because truly, it's always about the expectations that are set at the beginning of the engagement. You've got to know those, right? And then from there, right, the soft side, right, always empathize, right? I always, you know, the advice that I give you is make sure that, you know, take the threat out. You know, there's ways to take the threat out. You could say, hey, here's what I think I heard you say. You know, is that what you really meant, right? When there's a difficult client and you feel like the treatment is not right, you can go back and say, here's what I'm hearing you say, which is different than what he or she is saying. Am I right? And it just, it decreases, right? You allow the person to kind of relax so that then you can come back to the, here's what we're solving for. You know, that's what you get in the internships and all these opportunities to work with the companies so you can get better at it. And it's no different like going to the gym. It's a muscle that you build. The more that you do it, the better that you get at it.
Leslie, I might just add on that before you take on another question. With COVID, one of the things that we did see across several of our member firms was a cancellation of the internship program or scaling back due to the pandemic and just unsure of what that would mean for our business. So while we love internships and absolutely encourage them, for any of you who maybe were affected from your this past summer internship experience or maybe are seeing some limited opportunities going into this next summer, please know, and Rachel, you could probably speak to this too, the human resources professionals, the recruitment side understands that gap on your resume. But as Leslie mentioned, you definitely need to take it upon yourself to give your best effort to get one, but there will be some grace allotted because of this pandemic.
Yeah, in addition to that, and you know, like we were lucky enough to be able to still host a good amount of our interns, but did have to let some go just because workload, and like I said, in some industries were affected more heavily. But, you know, like for those of you who maybe had internships and they were canceled or cut short or whatever that looks like, affected in some way, we told those people who got released out of their control that, like, hey, you can still, you know, include this verbiage. And we gave them like a little sentence or two to say, like, you were selected for this internship and it didn't pan out, you know, just so that way it's like, it still adds a little bit of credibility to your resume. And we know that, like, you were selected through a competitive process, whatever that was. It still adds to the resume, but obviously it doesn't compare to an actual internship. But something, yes, that, like Mary said, we will be adding a little bit of grace in there, knowing that, like, there were a lot of things that were out of your control, including ours. And so everyone's just kind of have a little bit more empathy for sure when it comes to topics that were 2020 related.
Right. You know, and to your point, Rachel, anything that was 2020 that you can think of that you can put in your resume of this is, right, mm-hmm. this activity at home or in the community, right, in the neighborhood, right, yeah. challenged, right, here's what I did from a critical thinking. This is what we did to communicate. This is what we did to, right, to help and collaborate, you know, for those that were in need. Those are going to be tremendous in lieu of the standard internship. So make sure that you add that. Great. Mary, would you prefer that we continue looking at these? How would you like us?
Yeah, please. We have about, let's do one more question. There's a couple of good ones, Leslie, so I'll let you pick which one and direct it to the panelists.
Absolutely. I mean, there's a couple that, you know, there's a theme there that I would love for Jim, Darius, and Rachel to jump in too, around teams and specialties for different engineering majors. For example, would an electrical engineer work with other EEs, or would they be a unique part of a diverse group, right? I mean, it really, I would say, depends on the function and on the company, right? I would tell you for JE Dunn, right, project engineers, right? If you think about what we do, back to step back, what we do, we win work, we plan work, and we execute work. To plan the work, right, we actually need engineers, project managers to plan, to estimate, to do the pricing, to work with the business development folks to get it as tight as possible, right? To get it locked down, to start building, and then to monitor and project manage the build out. So if it's something very specific to the vertical, to the, you know, whether it's, you know, whether you're building a data center or solar panels or a high school or a sports center, right? If it's very specific to the area, then it's an electrical engineer working with other electrical engineers, right? If it is really monitoring and working with the life cycle of the project, then it can be more general, right? Then there's no reason why a mechanical or a civil, right, could actually do that work too. So there's options. And that's why I went back to know the more specific that you can get to know what you like, I think the better you'll be, right? There's some functions that tend to be more that more generalists, and some functions that are tends to be a lot more specific. If a mechanical engineer, a civil engineer, right, an architect, an electrical. So hopefully that helped. Jim, anything that you would add to that, or Rachel, Darius?
Yeah, one thing I would add is just the with our company, and ours is a smaller company, but the work we do doesn't necessarily lend itself to one precise type of engineering degree. We have architectural engineers here, mechanical engineers. We actually have some architects that work for us doing some similar project engineering type roles. And one thing that is really key, it's more that the problem solving methodology that an engineering degree gives you. Like that's the really critical thing. You know, electrical engineering, still get the problem solving ability, but not really directly related to what we do here. But it's more that we're looking for. And so it would be, back to the original question, kind of, it's a very broad team approach here. And again, we're similar industry to Dunn, actually, where we're doing construction. So we have project managers who a lot of times work their way from project engineers to project management positions. And again, it's about that problem solving mentality, I think.
Yeah, I'll jump in real quick, Rachel. Being on the architecture side, we don't have any in-house engineers at our office, but we do work with engineers. And I think part of the question was, would an electrical engineer work with another electrical engineer? And my answer would be, depends on the size of the project. For our larger projects, one engineer, you know, can't do it by themselves. So we sort of need more than one. In each particular field while simultaneously building out that whole engineering team to deliver that project for the client. So yes, you would, but a lot of times on the smaller projects, you would be the only one on their project, at least from my standpoint, in the way you approach the execution.
Yeah, I can agree with Darius and Jim and even Leslie too. It really depends on the firm, the project, etc. But this is a great question that you can even ask in any of the interviews that you get to like further get to know the company, and depending on what your goals or what you would like to do. But like speaking from Burns and Mac and everything, like there definitely is a lot more cross-disciplinary, you know, experience and conversations that you'll have, because a electrical power substation or a data center or a airport can't be built just by a mechanical engineer, or can't be built just by a civil. You know, you do have to collaborate, and we do have architects involved here along with engineers. So it's even, you're learning more of like the artistic and more aesthetic side of it alongside with the engineering as well. So yeah, it, again, just depends, but it's a great question to ask to further get to know the company if that you're interviewing and getting to know a little bit more.
Excellent, Rachel, thank you. Thank you. You know, there's a question here that I have to address just even a little bit because it's a great question. What can young professionals in the built environment do to make our industry a trailblazing force in the push to create more inclusive and equitable spaces and policies for historically marginalized groups of people? That is, it's been critical. And now, right, this year, shine a light of the criticality and importance and the need that we companies and everyone needs to do more. Well, I'll tell you a couple of things that you can do, right? Given that this year, it has pushed us, challenged us human beings to realize that we can do work differently and digitally and technically we have used virtual, you know, a lot more. I believe that this type of technology can help us scale to get the message out. It starts with awareness, then with engagement, and then with immersion. We can't immerse people in it if they don't know about it. If they don't know about it, right, it's very hard to get them to get an internship in a career here. My ask is just to make sure that, you know, you get involved when you start, you know, your job, your career in the company, to be those young engineers and those young professionals that are telling the stories virtually to hundreds, if not thousands of students. We have not been able to do that before. I believe that now education is a lot more prepared, 1,000 times more prepared than they were last year at this time, to be able to engage with us and scale there. We need more of you to tell that story. That's what we need. We need each of you to spend a couple of hours, right, of your time every month or every quarter to dedicate to create that awareness with students. Because the education's thirsty for that, and we'll be able to do that. So thanks for the question. Anything that you want to add, Rachel, Jim, and you know what you're doing in that area, Darius, please.
Sure. I agree with everything you said. And the simple fact that the question was asked is a far departure from past experiences. So I think that was a great first step. And then the other thing I would say, all of you are ambassadors/caretakers for society going forward. And as you get out into the workplace and become more powerful as your own individual entity, make sure you personally do the things that you need to do to make an equitable environment.
Yeah, I think the more that younger students, right, in elementary school sees you and us, right, sees Darius, sees me, right, as, oh my gosh, yeah, they're engineers. Yes, you're right. They can do it. I can do it, right? The more that they see it, mm-hmm. the more they can believe it. And we just need more of us. It's a scale thing.
When joining to the workforce, like I know that in college you have a lot of student organizations around you, like NSBE, SHIP, SWE, even your disciplinary ones, like those continue in the workplace. And oftentimes, especially if you're the firm that you end up working for is really large, they will have the professional groups too for, you know, post-grad level to still connect with like-minded folks and have those recurring meetings and get industry knowledge at the same time as like I said, meeting with like-minded people, you know, seek out different training too, because especially now with the movement and the relevance of the topic itself of just racial and gender equality is that a lot of companies are also providing more trainings for their managers for like unconscious biases or cultural intelligence, things like that. So, you know, ask those questions, seek them out and, yeah, hopefully the firms have those resources for you. And it's something that we're definitely growing in as well and developing more and more of.
Yeah. I'll tell you something I wish I would have done when I was in college, a couple of books that I should have read, because I was an engineer by training and I loved the numbers and I didn't love to read soft leadership stuff. I just loved my numbers and my math and my workflows and my processes. I wish someone would have told me read, and I would have read How to Make Friends and Influence People by Carnegie Hall. It's a great, simple, fun book. Download it, listen to it. Gives you a great perspective. A book that wasn't at the time, but a book that I would recommend you now, that is another simple one, that I wish I could have read is called now The Ideal Team Player by Lencioni. Super simple, how to be hungry, humble, and smart.
You should include those in the chat so that way everyone can write them down. I've heard of the first one, but not the second one. So I'm like, oh, wait, let me take note.
It's an awesome one. Yeah, it's a fun one. And it's an easy, super easy read.
Great. Great discussion, everyone. I think we're just right on schedule with scheduled now to get into our various breakout rooms. As a reminder, students, you'll be paired with an employer. We have several employers beyond just the employers that are on the panel today here to talk with you. And I know we didn't get to every question that you asked, but you guys did a great job coming up with great questions. So please, if your question wasn't answered or you want to dive a little bit deeper, now is a great time to do that with specific employers. Again, you'll have an opportunity to meet with three different employers during these breakout sessions that are to come. And in between each breakout session, DJ Joe's gonna come on and help us entertain the group while we do the behind the scenes work of pairing everyone into the different breakout rooms. So thank you, Leslie, Darius, Jim, and Rachel. This was an excellent panel discussion, and we hope it just prompts further discussion in the breakout rooms to follow.
Right, and well, welcome, DJ. It feels like we should follow like a Friday, right? Anyway.
Exactly. All right, so DJ Joe, you can take it from here.
Thank you. Thank you for setting us up.